Here's a magic trick. When I point this thing here directly towards you, then you can hear the music, it is playing back. But if I point it somewhere else, then you can hear pretty much nothing. And that is because this thing is a so-called directional speaker. Like the name implies, it shoots out its audio waves in a very directional straight beam, which is pretty much the complete opposite of what a common loudspeaker does, because those broadcast in all directions. This makes directional speakers suitable for a variety of specialized applications. And honestly speaking, I got myself this bi version here because I was simply curious to find out how they sound and how far you can transmit audio without anyone else around noticing. More about those things later in the video, because before getting to that, I have to say that I was not only shocked how pricey these directional speakers are, but after paying €250 for mine, it also arrived defective and simply didn't work. So in this video, let's find out how I repaired mine and how I came up with a DIY version that is way cheaper and potentially even better, so that we can ultimately answer the question whether you should DIY or buy such a directional speaker. Let's get started! If you're on a budget but still want high quality PCBs, then JLC PCB, my 8-year long sponsor, is your best choice. They offer 1-8 layer PCB prototyping and assembly starting at only $2. Such low prices are possible because they have large scale production and intelligent automated manufacturing, which also ensures consistently high quality. And right now you can get a $30 coupon for their 6 layer PCBs. So click the link below to claim your discount. To start off, let's have a closer look at my bi version, which for one arrived with the small board here that more or less only consists of a Bluetooth module so that I can wirelessly playback audio. And then we of course also got the big directional speaker system consisting of two boards. After separating them by removing four screws, we can see that the main speaker itself is made up of dozens of those round thingies here. And you might have seen those before when working with electronics, because they are simply ultrasonic transmitters. Usually you supply them with a small 40 kHz pulse that then travels through space, bounces back from an object, and can then get detected by a fitting ultrasonic receiver. And since we kept track of time, how long it took for the wave to return, and we know the speed of sound, we can simply calculate the distance to the object. Because yes, this thing is simply a distance sensor. So why do they use 49 of these transmitters here, which according to the PCB layout are all connected in parallel? Well, to find that out, I think we need to have a closer look at the driver PCB, whose main components are a voltage regulator, a microcontroller, and under the metal heatsink we got an old school audio amplifier. But since the microcontroller can do many different things, we obviously first need to power the board to see what is going on. And to do that, I daisy chained this board together with the Bluetooth board and hooked up the audio cable. After then powering this all with 24 volts, it seems like the Bluetooth board works just fine. But I feel like the driver board does nothing, because none of its LEDs lit up. I wonder if this has to do with these two spots here, where the soldering quality is just not good at all. So I put this thing under the microscope to have a closer look. And even though the quality is pretty bad, everything should work in theory. Eventually though, I found out that this big diode here got soldered in the wrong way, which was luckily a rather simple fix that immediately solved all problems. So time to put it all back together for proper first tests, and I gotta say that I was both happy and a bit underwhelmed. You see, I was happy that it works like a directional speaker, meaning that when I pointed at a specific object, then the sound waves hit that, and it sounds like the audio is coming from there. Meaning you can turn anything into a speaker, which is kind of trippy. And yes, you can hear the audio the loudest when getting directly hit by the beam, which honestly though does not feature the best audio quality. But it doesn't sound as bad in real life as what you hear right now. The reason is that the functional principle of such a speaker creates quite a bit of pressure that you can actually feel, and that does not pair well with microphone recordings. I mean, it kind of functions similar to an ultrasonic cleaner, and we all know how much pressure that can create. But anyway, as you can probably hear in this example, it also seems like the directional speaker itself still emits hearable audio, which is not what I hoped for. On the bright side though, this side effect was not such a big problem while doing tests outside, about which I will talk later. Because for now I have to mention that the audio amplifier and thus heatsink got quite hot. Which means it was finally time to find out how this speaker truly functions. To get a first clue, I hooked up the amplified audio signal to my oscilloscope. And as you can see, we are apparently dealing with a sine wave that comes with a frequency of 40 kHz. This frequency is of course the resonance frequency of the ultrasonic transmitters, which basically makes them move. And to let them do that, according to our audio signal, they seem to modulate the amplitude of the sine wave. To better showcase that though, let's inject a simple audio signal, which is this 3 Hz triangle wave. As you can see, when the triangle voltage is high, the sine amplitude is high as well. And when it is low, then the amplitude is also low. This way you can put all audio information in such an amplitude modulated or AM signal, which is probably done by this microcontroller, and then it gets all amplified by the audio amplifier, which all in all is a pretty straightforward and simple functional principle. And that begs the question, why price it at 250 euro? I mean, I got myself 50 even bigger ultrasonic transmitters for only 20 euro. And if we combine the cost for the rest of the components, then I feel like we're looking at an overall price of around 50 euro. But you know what? Let me prove it. To do that, I firstly designed myself a custom PCB for my transmitters, which took me around 20 minutes. And I ordered 5 of them for a price of only 20 euro including shipping. All thanks to JLC PCB of course. And after a week of waiting I received them. And of course immediately started populating one with 50 transmitters. And just like that my DIY directional speaker was done. And yes, it works just as good or bad as the buy version. So I was wondering whether amplitude modulation was really the best way to drive these things. I mean, maybe pulse width modulation achieves better results, in which we simply alter the pulse width of a 40 kHz square wave according to the audio signal. This way we would also be dealing with a digital signal that we could amplify with a MOSFET H-bridge. This has the main advantage that we create very little losses. So to carry out my plan, I firstly added a DC offset to the audio signal of my phone using a potentiometer. Then I combined an Arduino Nano with an AD9833 programmable waveform generator, a bit of code and an operational amplifier in order to create this adjustable 40 kHz triangle wave. By feeding this into a comparator along with the audio signal, we then get a PWM signal on the output whose duty cycle is modulated by the audio signal. sweet. But since I'm not a fan of this breadboard art, I next soldered all components onto a perf board to create a more sturdy circuit. And while I was at it, I also created a schematic for it all. The only thing missing now was an H bridge, and luckily for me, I found a powerful one on Amazon for only 8 euro. After hooking that one up to the PWM generator, as well as to my DIY speaker, I was super happy to find out that this PWM technique does also work perfectly fine, and creates pretty much the same, let's say, decent sounding audio. And that brings me to my final outdoor tests, which I did with both my DIY and buy system. And I gotta say that they both performed pretty much the same. The only noticeable differences were that my DIY system was a bit quieter and that it required less current and produced less heat, in direct comparison to the buy version. But other than that, they both performed great at a 15 meter distance, and I feel like they can do distances of double than that. And since now there were less surfaces for the audio to bounce off of, the speaker itself and the sound it emits also felt quieter. And thus, with more space, this really feels like a directional speaker. However, this effect works the best when being around 4 meters away from it, because the further you get away, the more the beam becomes like a cone. Yeah, it is certainly not easy to work with such speakers. But what is easier is adding up all my costs to realize that DIY cost me around 50 euro. And if we have a look at all the other facts about the buy and DIY version, then I have to say that for me, DIY is the clear winner here. So if you're interested in trying out such a speaker yourself, then definitely DIY one. As always, if you enjoyed this show, then don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.